Dear students, today we are going to discuss about grief counseling. Grief as pain and suffering must be experienced in order to heal and resolve the loss event. Feelings of loss and grief can be experienced after we lose someone or something that we care about, such as the death of a loved one, diagnosis of a terminal illness, a change to the way of life, loss of a relationship, a pet, a job, or of important possessions. When we lose someone or something important to us, it can take time to adjust and learn to live life without that person, thing, or way of life. After completion of this lesson, you would be able to understand the concept of grief counseling, analyze the strategies for assessment of a bereaved individual, know the stages of grief counseling. Now, let us get into the details of grief counseling. There is no right way or wrong way to grieve, and it can take a lot of time and support to heal. The grief experienced in these instances is not an illness or disease. It is a normal response to a life event which everyone may face at some point of time. In addition to its emotional expression, grief can be expressed in physical, behavioral, social, and cognitive ways. Now, let us look into different categories of loss. The loss types are many, and understanding the categories of loss is useful during the assessment of the bereaved to know the specific impacts of past and present losses, as well as direct and collateral impacts of different types of loss. The first is relationship. Death of a loved one, illness, divorce, separation, abandonment, rejection, abuse within a trusted relationship, moving out from parents' home, or moving out geographically from friends. The next, some aspect of self, relationship loss, abuse, sexualized violence, illness, physical change, hopes, major change, disappointments. Treasured objects. Objects that give a self-identity, objects that connect to a memory or sentiment, objects treasured from past heritage, family, home. Developmental, dumped by a lover, loss of job, loss of a role in a family, growing up and having to be independent, miscarriage, loss of freedom, retirement. In this way, based on this specific information, the counselor can educate, prepare and plan more effective intervention strategies for coping and grief resolution for the bereaved individual based on types of losses suffered in present and the past. This matrix would first be used as an assessment device by the counselor on what losses have what kind of impact on the client. Several sessions into the counseling process, it can then be used as an educational tool in assisting the client to reflect upon his or her life and gain insight about the pervasive nature of loss. Let's look into the symptoms of grief. The term normal grief, also referred to as uncomplicated grief, encompasses a broad range of feelings and behaviors that are common after loss. Symptoms of normal grief are somatic or bodily distress of some time, preoccupation with loss, guilt related to the circumstances of the loss, hostile reactions, inability to function as one had before the loss. During the first few months after a loss, many signs and symptoms of normal grief are the same as those of complicated grief. However, while normal grief symptoms gradually start to fade over time, those of complicated grief linger or get worse. Complicated grief is like being in an ongoing heightened state of mourning, which keeps an individual from healing. Signs and symptoms of complicated grief may include intense sorrow, pain, and rumination over loss of the loved one or loss event. Focus on little else but the loved one's death or loss event. Extreme focus on or excessive avoidance of reminders of the loved one's or loss event. Intense and persistent longing or pining for the deceased or loss event. Problems accepting the death or loss event. Numbness or detachment. Bitterness about the loss event. Feeling that life holds no meaning or purpose. Lack of trust in others. Inability to enjoy life or think back on positive experiences with the loved one or before the loss event. Complicated grief also may be indicated if an individual continues to have trouble carrying out normal routines, isolate self from others and withdraw from social activities, experience depression, deep sadness, guilt or self-blame, believe that the individual did something wrong or could have prevented the death or loss event. Feel life isn't worth living without the loved one or loss. Wish they had died along with the loved one or the loss did not occur. Now let's look into types of grief. Normal or uncomplicated grief. There really are no set guidelines to define normal grief in terms of timeless or severity of grief. Instead, think of normal grief as any response that resembles what you might predict grief to feel like in response to a loss event. Many people define normal grief as the ability to move towards acceptance of the loss. With this comes a gradual decrease in the intensity of emotions. Those who experience normal grief are able to continue to function in their basic daily activities. Complicated grief, that is traumatic or prolonged or unresolved grief. Complicated grief refers to normal grief that becomes severe in its duration and significantly impairs the individual's ability to function. It can often be difficult to judge when grief has lasted too long. Other contributing factors in diagnosing complicated or prolonged grief include looking at the nature of the loss or death. Was it sudden, violent, multiple? The relationship personality, life experiences, and other social issues. Some warning signs that someone is experiencing traumatic grief include self-destructive behavior, deep and persistent feelings of guilt, low self-esteem, suicidal thoughts, violent outbursts, or radical lifestyle changes. Delayed grief. Delayed grief is when reactions and emotions in response to a loss event are postponed until a later time. This type of grief may be initiated by another major life event or even something that seems unrelated. Reactions can be excessive to the current situation of loss, and the person may not initially realize that delayed grief is the real reason for becoming so emotional. Anticipatory grief. Anticipatory grief often starts when an individual gets a significant diagnosis, that is terminal or incurable illness, and their health begins to deteriorate. Feelings are related to the loss of what was or what you thought life was going to be like. It can be difficult for family members of such an individual to speak with others about anticipatory grief because the person is still alive and they may have feelings of guilt or confusion as to why they are feeling this kind of grief. Disenfranchised grief or ambiguous grief. Disenfranchised grief can be felt when an individual experiences a loss, but they or the significant others do not acknowledge the importance of the loss in the person's life. The individual or the significant others may not understand the importance of the loss, or they may minimize the significance of the loss. It means the losses are hard to define and therefore also hard to identify. Disenfranchised grief can occur when an individual experiences the loss of an ex-spouse, a pet, or a co-worker. The other side of disenfranchised grief is when an individual experiences a loss, such as when the person close to you has dementia or a decline in their physical abilities. The person close to you is physically present, but they are also absent in other significant ways. Chronic grief. This type of grief can be experienced in many ways. Through feelings of hopelessness, a sense of disbelief that the loss is real, avoidance of any situation that may remind the individual of the loss, or loss of meaning and value in a belief system. At times, people with chronic grief can experience intrusive thoughts. If left untreated, chronic grief can develop into severe clinical depression, suicidal or self-harming thoughts, and even substance abuse. Cumulative grief. This type of grief can occur when multiple losses are experienced by an individual, often within a short period of time. Cumulative grief can be stressful because you don't have time to properly grieve one loss before experiencing the next. Masked grief. Masked grief can be in the form of physical symptoms or other negative behaviors that are out of character. An individual experiencing masked grief is unable to recognize that these symptoms or behaviors are connected to a loss. Distorted grief. Unfortunately, distorted grief in an individual can present with extreme feelings of guilt or anger, noticeable changes in behavior, hostility towards a particular person, other self-destructive behaviors. Exaggerated grief. Exaggerated grief is felt by an individual through the intensification of normal grief responses. This intensification has a tendency to worsen as time moves on. This may result in self-destructive behavior, suicidal thoughts, substance abuse, abnormal fears, nightmares, and even the emergence of underlying psychiatric disorders. Inhibited grief. This type of grief is when an individual does not outwardly show any typical signs of grief. Often this is done consciously to keep grief private. Problems can arise with inhibited grief through physical manifestations such as chronic pains in the body, migraine, headaches, peptic ulcers, etc. when an individual do not allow themselves to grieve. Now, let us understand what is collective grief. Collective grief is felt by a group. For example, this could be experienced by a family, neighborhood, community, city or country as a result of a natural disaster, death of a public figure or a terrorist attack. Abbreviated grief is real, but it is short-lived response to a loss. It occurs when there is no perceived time to grieve. The loss might be minor. There is no strong attachment to the loss, or it is seen as a gain. This could also occur due to a person or thing immediately filling the void, the distance that was felt, or the experience of anticipatory grief. Absent grief. Absent grief is when an individual does not acknowledge the loss and shows no signs of grief. This can be the result of complete shock or denial of the death or loss event. It can be of concern if an individual experiences absent grief for an extended period of time. It is important to note that in some instances, just because one cannot see or make out the signs of grief, it does not necessarily mean that an individual is not grieving. Secondary losses in grief. Secondary loss is felt after the primary loss and can affect multiple areas of an individual's life. The grief from secondary loss is the emotional response to the subsequent losses that occur as a result of a death or loss event. Need for counseling. An individual may contact a mental health professional if they have intense grief and problems in functioning that don't improve at least 1 year after the passing away of the loved one or occurrence of a loss event. At times, people with complicated grief may consider suicide, and it's time for such individual to talk to someone they trust and subsequently contact a mental health professional. Camille Wotman and Roxane Silver found 4 differing patterns of grieving: normal, chronic, delayed, and absent. Bereaved clients, notwithstanding loss suffered, may approach for counseling at any point of time during the grief process. Acute stage. When the shock, passivity, and confusion experienced is the most and they are at loss of what to do. After a span of 6 months or more, after the loss event, as they feel that they ought to feel better by this time and find that they are not. Some others may have needed counseling help early on, but due to the experience of grief being a sign of weakness or it being negated or stifled or ignored in their socio-cultural context, come to work on their grief years later too when the loss event occurred. May never turn up for the grief work and continue to live with unresolved or unacknowledged or absent grief. Let us understand the strategies for assessment of a bereaved individual. Assessment is an ongoing process along with interventions, with one paving the way for another. Assessments provide matter or information for planning interventions that facilitate change, and this would prompt new issues to emerge to be worked upon by the counselor. Pre-counseling. Intake forms take basic information about a client, such as name, address, and phone numbers, the pressing concern to be addressed through counseling. When they wish to take the first session, their feelings like sadness, anger, loneliness, or suicidal ideation, any changes in habits, eating, sleep, alcohol, or drug use, and any preference to the counselor, gender, age, origin. The counseling intake form seeks some more background information about the client, who has referred them here, what brings them to counseling, their family members' details, others who are currently supportive to them, their medical history or counseling, when loss event occurred or relationship ended, and what dates or situations trigger grief reactions. Different line of questioning is used to probe into the one or more of the perspectives: philosophical, spiritual, sociological, cultural, physical, and psychological, with which the bereaved individual is processing the loss event and therefore outline the grief work cut out for him or her. Let's look into the philosophical aspect. How the loss has affected their outlook on life. If there is any personal philosophy that is helping them at this time. If they feel a sense of relation or connection to anyone or anything. If they felt similarly during other loss events in their past. What questions about life it has triggered. What this loss has made them aware of more. Spiritual belief in God or a higher being and afterlife, and how this loss affected it. Conception of sin and punishment. Rituals that they find meaningful and helpful. religious beliefs that sustain them most. Whether the religious or spiritual conviction helped with their past losses, any conflict with thoughts on your present loss and religious spiritual beliefs. Sociological, cultural. Questions to understand the dominant and client's own culture, how one was socialized, expectations because of race, gender, socioeconomic status, ethnicity and how they view themselves, family of origin, nuclear family and perceived support systems, client's perceived social status, sanction given or not due to the nature of loss. Psychological aspect. Questions to find out personality styles or characteristics that is dependent, histrionic, narcissistic, compulsive, etc., premorbid and present. Client's relationship with others, their sense of personal self-worth. Questions to gain clarity on their affective, that is feelings and mood and cognitive, thoughts and rationally, domains with respect to processing the loss event. Physical concept. Questions to explore psychosomatic systems, psychiatric care, medications, lack of sleep, nutrition and general areas of functioning. Daily functioning, a typical day, change in routine, what they are finding difficult to achieve in a day, do they have a daily goals? History of loss is an assessment tool to list and understand all the losses faced, clients' feelings, behaviors experienced, what aspects of grief were left unresolved and what changed in their life. Psychological tests help to identify anxiety, sadness, levels or any suicidal ideation if the bereaved client is herself or himself not aware. Therefore, bereavement counseling is successful with careful assessment of the categories of loss suffered by the bereaved client and by gaining an insight into the perspectives that influence his or her perception of loss. Understanding their history of loss and their psychological status and the grief work that they are willing to undertake. Let us discuss the stages of grief. Kubler-Ross model, based on grief experienced by individuals diagnosed with terminal cancer, the first one is shock and denial. I feel fine. This can't be happening, not to me. Denial is usually only a temporary defense for the individual. This feeling is generally replaced with heightened awareness of possessions and individuals that will be left behind after death or loss event. The second is anger. Why me? It's not fair. How can this happen to me? Who is to blame? Once in the second stage, the individual recognizes that denial cannot continue. Because of anger, the person is very difficult to care for due to misplaced feelings of rage and envy. The next is bargaining. I will do anything for a few more years to live. I will give my life savings if. The third stage involves the hope that the individual can somehow postpone or delay death or an anticipated loss event. Usually, the negotiation for an extended life is made with a higher power in exchange for a reformed lifestyle. Depression. I'm so sad. Why bother with anything? I'm going to die or face the loss event. What's the point? I miss my loved one. Why go on? During the fourth stage, the dying or aggrieved person begins to understand the certainty of death or the loss event. Because of this, the individual may become silent, refuse visitors and spend much of the time crying and grieving. This process allows the dying person or the one facing a loss to disconnect from things of love and affection. It is not recommended to attempt to cheer up an individual who is in this stage. It is an important time for grieving that must be processed. The next in the stage is acceptance. It's going to be okay. I can't fight it. I may as well prepare for it. In this last stage, the individual begins to come to terms with her or his mortality or the loss event. An eclectic view was proposed by the Grief Recovery Institute, started by James W. after the death of his own 3-year-old son. James, in coordination with Russell P. Friedman, founded the Grief Recovery Institute, a huge nonprofit with over 2,500 centers. He felt the terminology and the concepts of Kubler-Ross were not accurate and thus reinterpreted the 5 stages as the following. The first, disbelief, shock, numbness, was a more appropriate feeling than denial. The second, anger. He felt this was not a universal feeling, as not all deaths are the same, such as someone finally dying after suffering from a long disease or someone who was killed by a drunk driver. Yes, there is anger at the disease or the drunk driver, but he did not believe this was a stage. Third, yearning for their loved one instead of bargaining. The fourth is depression. He believed that though the following list were the symptoms of grievers as well as symptoms for clinical depression, and that this did not mean a person was depressed. Inability to concentrate, disturbance of sleeping patterns, upheaval of eating patterns, roller coaster of emotions, lack of energy, acceptance was relative to the person and event and required an individual to admit that it was over and the person is gone. Progression of counseling sessions in grief work. There is no standard number of counseling sessions for undertaking grief work. Clients may take a few sessions to sessions stretched over 2 years to accomplish their grief resolution. First, let us understand early sessions. Early counseling sessions are marked by acute experiences of painful grief. Pain is felt physically, psychologically, spiritually, cognitively, and emotionally, and the client feels a total loss of control over their life. Clients feel overwhelmed and will doubt whether they will survive the loss and grieving experience. The focus of the counselor would be to plan interventions such as continue on going assessment, encouraging the personal narrative, expression of emotions, taking up mourning rituals, and the provision of needed support, that is non-judgmental listening, along with parallel exploration into the contributions to the client's life of their present and past losses. Middle sessions, middle parts of the counseling process, reflect more expressions of continued pain and torment of adjusting to and grieving in an environment where the loss event took place. During the later period of the middle sessions, the clients may express of willingness and ability to adapt and accommodate to the changed circumstances, that is resiliency. Once they are past the acute phase socially and psychologically, they feel more in control of their emotions and lives. Later sessions. Major part of these sessions address the experience of letting go of former roles and identities and making new choices to initiate new life narratives. As grief is a cyclical process, it is possible that the client experiences what was felt in early and middle sessions due to some trigger events, places, people, social situations, anniversaries, etc. During these sessions, a framework for exploration and rebuilding life based upon specific needs may be used for assessment and new goals may be set.